Hi, this is Nagesh Prabhu, Professor and Head Department of EEE, NMAM Institute of Technology, NITE. This is the last topic of Module 2, the control of voltage profile. In this topic, we are going to discuss about how to control and keep the voltage profile within the permissible limits for various buses. In the classification of buses, certain buses are classified as PV buses. In PV buses, the voltage control is possible by locating suitable devices. Some of the voltage control methods are discussed in the sections to follow. Voltage control at a PV bus. And we know that in PV bus, PI and VI are specified. The desired reactive power injection, QI, need to be supplied to maintain the terminal voltage to the specified value, VI specified. If desired QI cannot be supplied, the specified voltage magnitude VISP cannot be maintained. Now, how to supply this desired reactive power requirement at the bus QI? So that can be supplied by generator excitation control. At a PV bus where a generator is connected, the terminal voltage can be controlled by adjusting the generator excitation. Let us see how this can be done. Consider a generator modeled as a voltage source, that is G voltage source of magnitude EGI, behind the synchronous reactance XDI. And this generator is connected to ith bus as shown in this figure. Now PGI plus JQGI are the powers injected by this generator, and the bus is ith bus where the generator is connected. And the ith bus voltage is VI at an angle delta I. Now, generator excitation EMF magnitude is EGI and its angle is delta GI. The active and reactive power generation by the generator is given by PGI is equal to EGI VI divided by XDI whole into sin delta GI minus delta I. Similarly, QGI is equal to EGI divided by XDI into EGI cos of delta GI minus delta I minus VI. For small load angles where delta GI minus delta I is nearly equal to 0, we get QGI is equal to EGI by XDI whole into EGI minus VI. And we can control QGI by varying EGI, because for a bus, suppose if VI is constant, then we can, and XDI is also constant, then QGI can be varied or QGI can be changed by changing the magnitude of EGI. And how to change the magnitude of EGI? By changing the excitation. This we will consider in the next slide. Now, taking ith bus as reference, delta I is equal to 0. In general, for any given load angle delta GI, generator reactive power is given as QGI is equal to EGI by XDI into EGI cos delta GI minus VI. Now, suppose you carefully look at this expression. Suppose if EGI cos delta I is equal to VI, then the term inside the parenthesis becomes a 0 and QGI is equal to 0. So that is what is shown here. See, this is the vector diagram where VI is taken as reference. VI is the ith bus voltage and EGI is the generated voltage of the generator connected to ith bus. So now, since it is a generator, EGI is leading VI by a load angle delta GI, and the component of EGI which is in phase with VI is equal to EGI cos delta GI. Now, if EGI cos delta GI is equal to VI, that means EGI cos delta GI minus VI, this term becomes 0 and QGI becomes 0. So now this condition is called as 100% excitation, wherein we get VGI wherein we get EGI cos delta GI is equal to VI and QGI is equal to 0. And in such condition, no reactive power flows to the grid. So this is what is called as unity power factor operation, and reactive power supplied by the generator is equal to 0. So now what is going to happen when we overexcite the generator? When we overexcite the generator, EGI magnitude is greater than VI, and we can easily make out from this phasor diagram as EGI cos delta GI is greater than VI. This is what is called as overexcitation. And now EGI cos delta I, when it is greater than VI, QGI becomes positive, and it is to be understood that now the generator is supplying reactive power to the grid. Now we will see under excitation condition wherein EGI cos delta GI is less than VI. So here we get QGI as negative, and now the reactive power is absorbed by the generator, and reactive power flows from the grid to the generator. So now it is very evident that the condition for active power flow and condition for reactive power flow, what we had discussed in earlier lectures, can be very well appreciated here. So condition of active power flow is active power will flow from leading voltage point to lagging voltage point. That means if it is a generator, delta GI should be positive. Okay, so that means EGI is leading the bus voltage VI, and generator supplies active power. So similarly, the magnitude of voltage EGI should be greater than VI in order that QG to be supplied to the grid. So that means reactive power flows from higher magnitude voltage point to lower magnitude voltage point. So if EGI is higher, EGI magnitude is higher than VI, reactive power flows from generator to power system via this ith bus. So if EGI is made less than VI by under-exciting the generator excitation control, then reactive power is absorbed from the ith bus. So this is what is the inference of reactive power control by varying the generator excitation. Now, from a given load flow solution, PGI, QGI, and VI at an angle delta I are obtained. Now, generated EMF EGI can be adjusted. We have studied now how to adjust to give the required reactive power generation by adjusting the excitation of the generator. And the input from the prime mover is adjusted to obtain the reactive, to obtain the required value of a PGI plus losses of the generator, so that the difference in load angle is maintained at delta GI minus delta I. Now, in case if the required QGI is beyond the generator's capacity, what do we do? We have to have a reactive power generator, like an additional capacitor or maybe an additional synchronous condenser must be connected to the ith bus. Now, how do we control voltage control at a PQ bus? Voltages at the load buses can be obtained from the load flow solution. Now, if the voltage at the load bus is less than the specified lower voltage limit for the power system, say lower voltage limit is say 0.95 per unit, and upper voltage limit can be taken as say 1.05 per unit. So now, if the load bus voltage at any load bus, if it is less than the specified lower voltage limit, that means the reactive power demand at that bus cannot be met. In such cases, it is necessary to install VAR generators or static VAR compensator systems at some load buses also, and we can supply the reactive power demand accordingly. In such a case, load bus to be treated as PV bus, and the reactive generation at the bus obtained from the load flow solution gives the requisite reactive power injection at that bus. In modern power system, static VAR compensators are used to maintain the voltage within the limits at a load bus. SVC uses power electronic switches along with the passive elements. So SVC is the combination of thyristor controlled reactor in parallel with say fixed capacitor. So now this combination, by varying the firing angle of the thyristors, we can vary the reactive power. And hence, SVC can both generate as well as absorb the reactive power depending on the bus voltage control feedback. So now, other sophisticated VAR compensators like STATCOM, which is a static compensator, SPFC, which is a series power flow controller, etc., are available, which uses advanced power electronic switches like gate turn-off devices with the additional capability to turn off the devices at our will. We can also control the voltage by using transformer tap changing under load. Some transformers are provided with the taps which can be changed under load. The turns ratio is changed by a small amount delta A if VKR minus VK specified at any kth bus is greater than epsilon V. Epsilon V is the voltage tolerance or change in voltage tolerance for any bus. Now, VKR is the magnitude of the voltage at bus K in any iteration R. Now, if delta A is not very large, additional iterations need not be performed to obtain the voltage solution. To check for the voltage magnitude, we can have alternate iterations. Now, the voltage magnitude tolerance, epsilon V, can be taken to be 0.01 per unit for TCUL, that is transformer tap changing under load, to give acceptable limits. Every time the tap of a transformer is connected between a ith and a kth bus, then elements of Y bus, that is YII, YKK, YIK and YKI of the bus admittance matrix have to be updated before continuing with the iterations. Now, let us also see how the voltage control can be affected using phase shifting transformers. The phase shifting transformer, apart from changing the voltage magnitude, also shifts the phase angle between the two buses. It can be modeled as an impedance or admittance, which is equal to the transformer impedance connected in series with the ideal transformer. See, you can see here, this is the ideal transformer. And its turns ratio is A is to 1, where A is the complex number and it is the complex turns ratio. So now YT is the transformer admittance, and this transformer is shown ideal now, and its impedance or admittance is separately shown as a YT. Now, since the transformer is ideal, complex power output is equal to complex power input. Hence, we can write SP. SP is the complex power at a pth bus, which is equal to VP into IPQ conjugate, should be equal to the intermediate bus. You can see its voltage is VP by A, and current which is flowing out of this bus, intermediate bus, is IPQ dash. So we can always write SP is equal to VP IPQ conjugate is equal to VP by A IPQ dash conjugate. So now, from this equation 1, we can write IPQ. We can write IPQ is equal to IPQ dash by A conjugate. And for the line, this is the line. So we can write VP by A minus VQ, okay, into YT is equal to IPQ dash. So now, or we can now rewrite IPQ is equal to IPQ dash by A conjugate. So if we substitute all these values, then we will get YT by A square into VP minus YT by A conjugate into VQ. So that means IPQ can be written as a YT by A square VP minus YT by A conjugate VQ. Then also IQP is in this direction, the current direction from Q to Q to P, that is equal to VQ minus VP by A into admittance YT. So that can be simplified as IQP is equal to minus YT by A VP plus VQ into YT. So that means if you carefully look at IPQ and IQP, they are not same. So that means we can conclude from these two equations that the phase shifting transformer element cannot be represented by a single bilateral network. Rather, we need to represent now the different admittance matrix Y, and it is given by YT by A square as the first element minus YT by A conjugate. Then third, second row, first element is minus YT by A and Y22 is equal to YT. This means if there is a phase shifting transformer of complex turns ratio A and admittance YT between buses P and Q, then the elements of bus admittance matrix are to be modified as follows on addition of the phase shifting transformer. So YPP new is equal to YPP old plus YT by A square. YQQ new is equal to YQQ old plus YT. YPQ new is equal to YPQ old minus YT by A conjugate. YQP new is equal to YQP old minus YT by A. Now the turns ratio is complex and can be represented as A is equal to magnitude A into cos theta plus J sin theta. If the phase shift from bus P to Q is positive, then the voltage at bus P leads the voltage at bus Q. So I should thank all of you for giving me the opportunity to deliver lectures in e-Sikshana program. And I should specially acknowledge the efforts rendered by Mr. Abdul Rahman, Assistant Professor, Department of E&E, NMAMIT, NITTE, in preparing these slides. So thank you all.